Welcome back to Pattern Recognition. So today we want to continue looking into AdaBoost, and in particular we want to see the relation between AdaBoost and the exponential loss. So, boosting fits an additive model in a set of elementary basis functions. So, the result of boosting are essentially created by expansion coefficients beta and some b, which is a basis function given a set of parameters gamma. So, these additive expansion methods are very popular in learning techniques. You can see that very similar things are already applied in single hidden layer neural networks, building on the perceptron, in wavelets, in classification trees, and so on. So the expansion models are typically fit by minimizing a loss function L that is averaged over the training data. So you essentially can write this as L over the entire training data, and then you can plug in our definition, and you see that we have this additive model that is essentially given by our function fm. So the forward stage-wise modeling approximates the solution to 1. So the new basis functions are sequentially added, parameters and coefficients of already added functions are not changed, and at each iteration only a subproblem of fitting just a single basis function is solved. So we can express now the mth subproblem in the following way. So we essentially have the loss of the m minus 1 solution plus beta and the current estimate, and we are minimizing over gamma and beta. Now, AdaBoost can be shown to be equivalent to forward stage-wise additive modeling using an exponential loss function. So if our loss function equals to the exponent of minus y times f of x, we are essentially constructing the AdaBoost loss. So let's prove this. For AdaBoost, the basis functions are the classifiers gm, and they produce the output of either minus 1 or plus 1. Using the exponential loss function, we now must solve at every step that we essentially minimize over beta and g the sum over the exponential loss. If we now introduce a weight that we introduce here as wi, and we set it to exponent of minus y times f m minus 1 of xi, we can rewrite this as a minimization over this weighted sum of exponential functions. So we have some observations with this. Since the wi is independent of beta and g of x, it can be seen as a weight that is applied to each observation. However, this weight depends on the previous functions, so the weights change with each iteration m. This then allows us to reformulate this problem a little. We split it up into the misclassified and the correctly classified samples, and then we are able to rearrange this minimization expression, and you see that we can again use our indicator function here for representing the misclassified samples. Now, for every value of beta greater to 0, the solution for this minimization process is found as the minimization over the sum of the weight times the indicator function. So if we plug the reformulated gm into the objective function and solve for beta m, this yields that beta m is given as 1 over 2 times the logarithm of 1 minus the error m divided over the error m, where error m is the minimized weighted error rate, and here you see that it is essentially the misclassification weight summed up divided by the total sum over the weights. Now from the update formula of the approximation, we can calculate the weights for the next iteration. So here we can now see that we can use this identity here and derive the new weight. So here you see that then alpha m is going to be 2 beta m. If we now compare this result to the AdaBoost algorithm, we can see that the exponential loss had these solutions for beta m, alpha m, and the weights. And if you look into AdaBoost, this had essentially an alpha that is very much related to the above alpha, respectively beta, and also the weight update takes a very similar form. So you could say AdaBoost is essentially minimizing the exponential loss. Now let's look at the losses that we want to minimize. If we have the misclassification loss, that's actually hard to minimize because it's not a convex problem. But if you look into the squared error, this would be a first approximation of the misclassification loss. And then we can see that a better approximation of the misclassification loss is actually done here by the exponential function, so the exponential loss that is produced by AdaBoost. And we can also see that if we take a support vector machine, we essentially end up with a loss that is related to the hinge loss. And we see that also the SVM is solving a convex optimization problem with respect to just a different approximation of the misclassification loss. So this is quite interesting. If you're more interested in the relation between the hinge loss and the SVM, we also have a derivation for this in our class Deep Learning. So we could show that the AdaBoost algorithm is equivalent to forward stage-wise additive modeling, and this was actually only discovered 5 years after its invention. The AdaBoost criterion yields a monotone decreasing function of the margin y times f of x, and in classification the margin plays a role similar to the residuals in regression. So observations with yi times f of x greater 0 are classified correctly. Observations with this term smaller than 0 are misclassified, and the decision boundary is exactly at f of x equals to 0. So the goal of the classification algorithm is to produce positive margins as frequently as possible. Thus, any loss criterion should penalize negative margins more heavily than the positive ones. So the exponential criterion concentrates much more on the observations with large negative margins. So this is also in relation that we iteratively try to weigh up the samples that are really hard to classify. Due to the exponential loss, AdaBoost performance is known to degrade rapidly in situations of noisy data and where wrong class labels are in the training data. So again, training data and correct labeling is really a key issue, and if you have problems with the labels, then AdaBoost may not be the method of choice. So next time in pattern recognition, we want to look into a very popular application of AdaBoost, and this is going to be face detection, and you will see that AdaBoost and HAAR wavelets together, they essentially solve the task of face detection very efficiently, and this then gave rise to many, many different applications. And as you actually see in many cameras and smartphones, often the face detection algorithm that is used to detect people on the image and show it on boxes, this is very often done using the AdaBoost algorithm. So I hope you liked this little video, and I'm looking forward to seeing you in the next one. Bye bye.